The Pilsen area is designated by the Illinois EPA as, it falls within the, our definition of an environmental justice area. Thus, because, you know, we have all kinds of various transactions at the agency, one of which is that if someone wants to build a new source of air emissions, they have to get a permit from us, okay? We, as part of our environmental justice program, have committed to do certain forms of outreach within the context of the environmental justice arena, okay, in environmental justice areas. And what the form that typically comes in, at least initially, is as a notification to see whether a transaction that's before us, if there's interest in the community to know more about it. Okay, that's what has happened in this case. We were contacted by Perro to, because we have this transaction in front of us, which Chris will talk about in a second, a little bit. Just so that, I let me ask you this. I mean, how many people know about the transaction that's in front of you? Do you guys, do you want us to walk through that a little bit?
Yeah, briefly.
Yeah, okay, yeah. That's where I was going to go with this, but just let's ask the question, because why go through it all? So anyway, so one thing I want to mention, so what I want to mention is, you've signed in tonight. In the future, we'll notify you of transactions that are in front of the agency before us. So, but you will see essentially the various different transactions that come in front of the agency. So, whether they're of interest to you or not. Okay. So we received a letter from Keith representing Perro that asked for the meeting. So that's when we received those requests, we determined that it was in the interest to hold a meeting, so that's what we're doing tonight. So Chris will go through the background a little bit briefly, discuss what the application is. Keith had submitted questions to us, so we can go through those in a, you know, kind of broadly go through those. Then we have put together a draft permit, and we were going to give people a certain amount of time to look through the draft permit and make comments on it. So so that's, I guess that's, and then, you know, I think we would just then welcome whatever questions you had on that. So if that sounds like a good way to proceed.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, as Brad indicated, I'll talk a little bit about some of the background of the facility and then get into the application that's before us right now. A little bit of background, I'll sort of start around 2010 when the Illinois EPA put in the lead monitor at the Perez lead monitor. And right about 2010, we were getting some high readings on the lead monitor, some exceedances of the national ambient air quality standards. And obviously that was raising alarm bells with us. So we took action, referred it to the Attorney General's office, and also the federal government got involved. And about 3 years later, in March of 2013, that lawsuit was settled. And some of the things that came out of that was, you know, not only were we concerned with the monitored results at Perez from stack emissions or coming off the bag house or coming up that were captured and sent out of a stack, but also fugitive emissions. So we were looking at, in a part of that enforcement action, they're looking at tightening up the building so you're getting good suction into the control devices so that things are being captured, vented as they were supposed to be into the control system. Probably the most important thing that really came out of this whole process was the installation of two new bag houses, state-of-the-art bag houses that were not just your typical bag houses that capture particulate matter, and of course the number one thing we're concerned about would be the lead, but it also put on an additional layer of protection that you don't often see on bag houses, which is HEPA filtration, so even taking it to a smaller level. So the two new bag houses were installed, tightened up the building a little bit, or a lot of it. Also, as part of that enforcement action and permits that were issued proximate to construct those bag houses, there was bag leak detection systems that it's a state-of-the-art monitoring system that not all bag houses have that tells you if you're starting to lose pressure, which means either they're clogging up or there's a hole in it or something's happening, and that would be an indicator that you're losing your capture efficiencies. There's additional monitoring and record keeping, so really that was the centerpiece. Well, sort of segueing back to the monitor, since about that time, the 2000 and time in late 2010 to early 2011, there haven't been any monitored exceedances. So we're going on pushing 5 years with no exceedances of the lead NACs, which is obviously good news. Be that as it may, the Illinois EPA had requested that US EPA designate the area as non-attainment for lead. That's still pending with US EPA, that formal designation. And that would add more stringent, related to that process, would be our Part 226 lead rules that were also enacted that are really just applicable to H. Kramer. And then there's a facility in Southern Illinois that was in a similar boat as far as monitored exceedances. So we had we put out a lead rule that requires a lot of record keeping, a lot of monitoring, testing to make sure that they're staying, not just that you install a bag house and okay, everything's fine, that they're keeping an eye on the operation of the bag house. So that's all been, in at least in our estimation, good news. And then, well, does anybody have any, I'm going to segue into the application at hand, but I should pause for a second. I know I briefly touched on a lot of bigger topics, but any questions about what I just said?
Yeah, you mentioned about non-attainment in the area. Could you go into that a little bit more?
Yeah.
Do you want to? Or
you can.
Okay. I mean, when you talk about what does non-attainment mean?
Yeah, what does it mean and what are the effects and...
Okay, so the federal US EPA sets standards for their health-based standards for certain criteria pollutants, one of them being lead. So it was 2009, I want to say January of 2009, that their most recent, and then they have to go back and every so many years have to reevaluate and look at new health standards. So 2009, they evaluated. They went back and reevaluated lead, and then in January 2009, they lowered the standard to 0.15, Chris?
Yeah.
Yes. And then the states have to do is they have to evaluate the air quality in the state and determine what areas do and do not meet the lead standard. And that's where we come to the monitor. And generally, with lead, it was looking at what are the sources of lead in the state.
That emitted more than half a ton
of lead in a year.
Okay.
And so when an area is designated besides what Chris said, when it came to these two specific facilities in the state and putting specific stringent requirements on those two facilities, what in general a non-attainment area does is when you have new construction at a facility, it may trigger different levels. It's really with non-attainment's more, I think most people are probably more familiar, and it happens more frequently with other types of pollutants such as ozone, where you regulate not NOx and VOM, because most facilities emit those types of pollutants because of fuel burning and things like that. So it can trigger more restrictive requirements when it comes to new construction.
And I mean, I could make a copy if there was a copy machine. I didn't think to bring extra copies, but we did in May of 2013, we put out a fact sheet that it's from 2013, but it goes into, and I'm sure it's still up on our website, yeah, although it may be good luck. Yeah, if we could email you a PDF of it or something if you're interested. But it kind of, obviously you're hearing us go back and forth. There's a lot of information, but this, it goes over the background, the NACs, the tightening of the standard, the non-attainment area, and sort of does probably a better job than we're doing right now of sort of condensing it and summarizing.
I'll say one other thing. Like Chris said, the designation is based on a 3-month average of the highest monitor readings. We haven't had, I haven't even been close to having a 3-month average for the past 4.5 years that's even close to the standard. I think, and it's been steadily kind of dropping.
Sure.
And we are looking at, I think we just on September 22nd submitted a redesignation proposal to US EPA to redesignate the area as meeting the attainment as being in attainment, because US EPA requires 3 years of data, and we now have more than 4.
Sure. Okay.
It's showing that the air quality meets the standard.
Thanks.
Can I ask a quick question? I just want to make sure I'm understanding. So does that mean that prior to January 2009, the facility was emitting more than 0.5 ton of lead a year into the air?
Yes, the potential to emit 0.5 ton of lead.
Yeah. As of beginning when?
How long has H. Kramer been in existence?
1888.
Just want to make sure I was getting that right.
Okay. Well, yeah. Thank you. That was helpful.
You're welcome. So then you transition to the application that brings us here today, and H. Kramer applied for an application to install a new rotary furnace. They currently have two, what they designate as 1 and 2 furnaces. They propose to add a third furnace. And I know that one of the questions that came up, a logical question, is, okay, well, are they gonna operate all 3 of them? What's going on with the third furnace? Is it gonna greatly increase capacity? What are we talking about here? You know, we thought we made all these gains. Are we backtracking? So I don't think it was ever, H. Kramer submitted a letter of clarification as part of the permit application to clarify that once 3 becomes operational, which will be some time, I mean, it probably may take a year, maybe take 2 years to construct, because it's a big deal. They gotta lay a foundation. It's not gonna just roll it in overnight. But they sent a letter to us clarifying that, yes, once 3 is operational, then 2 will no longer be operational. And I think that the practical way to think about this is that they're going to, at least what they've represented us, utilize ductwork from 2. They're going to move it over so they can duct it to the baghouse. So that's what, again, that's what's important, is the capture of emissions off of the furnace. So that number 2 furnace will be no more. It won't be used, there's no stacking emissions on top of each other. So the new furnace, the idea would be more efficient. And again, one of the keys that's important is to, looking at these emission units, is to always keep in mind is whatever gets ducted that baghouse, if that baghouse is operating efficiently, that's what we're looking at, because these are 2 brand new baghouses. and with HEPA filtration, which is doing a good job, controlling emissions. One of the other parts of it, so the clarification that yes, that other two furnaces going bye-bye. Another question sort of I think that was posed is, okay, what are we gonna do to make sure everything is doing its job, like the venting's doing the proper job, the emissions are getting captured, things that are going to the bag house or that we're getting the type of reduction. So there will be, and I think you'll see in the draft permit, a requirement to do testing. Also of importance is looking back at our lead rule that was proposed, sort of on the topic of another question that was posed in Mr. Harley's letter, was looking at, you know, venting. It, all part of the stack testing process is gonna look at that. How it's ducted, what the capture is, the flow is going into the control system, and then you look at, measure what's actually coming out, and then measure that against extremely stringent emission rates that are in the permit, in the lead rule, and so on and so forth. So that's really the nuts and bolts of the permitting transaction. Again, I don't think you're gonna see anything happen overnight in regards to that. It's gonna take some time for them to do some construction, lay down foundation and do all that. But that, again, it's fairly straightforward. I know that there was a question that had to do with about the heat input correction.
Yeah.
And it's, we're still, so in some ways it's a complex answer to that, in some ways it's not a complex answer, but the bottom line is they applied in their construction permit to correct the heat input, and they're representing that the heat input was not correct previously. Now we're inquiring, and I don't know if we'll ever get an answer, and I, as to what was wrong in the past about it. But what we can say about it is that, one, it has little to no impact on lead emissions. It does, since we're talking about heat input, and what we're talking about is how much the burner on these furnaces, how much they're rated, how hot, how much can they burn. And we've adjusted those numbers up, and then we look at what are the emissions consequences of those adjustments, and what those...
And how much natural gas they're burning, right?
Yeah, based on how much natural gas they're burning. That's what it goes down to. It's like the... For instance, on number one, it was rated in the prior permit 11.5 million BTUs, and in what they've indicated the correct number is 18 million. Number two, what we had previously been told it was 20.8, it's going to 24. And then number three, which doesn't exist, is the proposed one, is gonna be rated at 18. So one little important note to that is that three is replacing two. So two was at 20.8, which is what they said before. The correct one is 24, but number three will be 18. So it's actually decreasing, and it'll be in line with what number one is. But again, what is the question becomes, what is the emissions consequences of all of this? And what it means is, from the way it's currently permitted in their operating permit, we look at carbon monoxide, we look at NOx, we look at PM, we look at our particulate matter, we look at volatile. So all of the consequences of these readjustments is those emissions go up. So you're talking about in CO going from 11.6 to 15.1, NOx 13.4 goes to 18, PM 1.1 goes to 1.4, VOM 0.8 goes to 1.
So it seems they have less heat, and it sounds like they're downsizing furnace 2 with furnace 3, but somehow we're creating more emissions?
Well,
Is that because furnace one has actually been upgraded in some respect?
Well, is it an efficiency issue or is
Our approach is pretty simple. Emissions are calculated based on gas usage. So you are right that replacement by itself of furnace number two with furnace number three decreases
by
firing
six.
Rate and respectively emissions.
Sure.
Emissions. But because they discovered that their furnace number one was underrated and they requested higher gas usage for furnace number one, combined emission slightly increased.
What was the how much did it burn, the furnace number one burn before? And
it
now
was
it's at
rated 11.5.
Okay.
And now they indicated it is 18 million BTU.
So the point being is there's no change there, but the rating is different. So it's not that it's not good, it's just that there's, it was incorrectly rated.
The equipment wasn't modified.
There won't be, it's not that in the future there's a change to the, to that.
And
that
all,
right.
All these years, they operated in terms of gas usage well within permit limits.
Okay.
So even in spite of high actual firing rate that it was permitted, they still, they do not run furnaces at full capacity. They use as much heat as they needed, and it usually significantly below than permitted limits.
Right. So. For us, if this was something that when it was disclosed or if we discovered it, that it was a violation, we would be issuing a violation notice, we would be pursuing it. This isn't, this didn't result in any regulatory exceed, the corrected number doesn't result, what Anatoly's saying, in a permit violation. It doesn't result in a regulatory violation where there was any limit that, oh, you were limited at 10. What it has to do with is our it's an input into the equation that gives us how much emissions they are, but they never were for those particular pollutants. They never were at a cutoff point where, oh, you now that we recalculated, you crossed the line and you're over. And also another aspect of this, which you know we encounter from time to time, the situation, this is how it's all, that's how it's been. So it's not an real world increase, it's a paper increase, it's a paper, if they're saying it was rated at this, but it was actually, oh, we dusted off the placard and it's really a 18 million BTU burner. Well, it's always been an 18 million. It's never been, it's always, it's, it is what it is. It's, and so that doesn't, and with the addition of the third furnace, if you compare two to three, it is getting more efficient, it's lower heat input, it's less emissions. Because you're going from 24 on number two to 18. So that's a decrease. But because number one was getting re-rated, that results in net.
One is going up seven, the other is going down six.
Right, exactly.
In the rating, but the emissions never reached, so they didn't use the full capacity is what you're saying, which is why they never were in violation, or?
Nobody uses full capacity, it's practically impossible. And for their operations, they don't need maybe to maintain the highest possible temperature. Depends what kind of product they're doing, what is the load to the furnace, or maybe operating the same amount of hours, but natural gas usage will be much lower.
And I don't think, and he's bringing to my mind another super critical point that I don't think we, I've certainly haven't really hit on is, and that was another question that was in Keith's letter is, so what when we're looking at facilities generally, whether it's H. Kramer or any other facility, we look at what is your absolute, if you were running 24/7, 365, nonstop, full tilt, what is the emissions consequences? Nobody does that, but that's what we, for the regulatory, to see what permits you need, what rules we need to be looking at, that might impact your facility. So that's kind of what we're talking about. When we're looking at max emission rates, we're looking at that and our calculations, and then how we need to, or what the permit emission limits then result. But just because somebody, when I'm throwing out these numbers that they're going to 11 to 15, 13 to 18, 1 to 1, you know, 1.1, that doesn't mean that they're necessarily hitting that in the real world, that that's what's coming out. That just means that's the most they can emit.
Okay. I think I got all that. Does that make sense to you, Keith?
Yeah.
All right.
Just the draft you gave us?
Yeah.
It says grant operating permit denial. And then on the last, next to last page, it says the operating permit application is denied. Can you talk a little bit about kind of the what that means?
Yeah, interplay, sure. So in this particular case, and in a lot of cases, when you're constructing a new emission unit and there's going to be a requirement to do testing, as there is in here, we're not going to carte blanche to say we're going to give you an operating and construction permit.
Okay.
Yeah, so what we've done is say, once it's constructed, you can operate it for a year pursuant to the construction permit, and you need to complete testing. Once you complete testing, you've submitted the results to us, you've come back to us with an operating permit application with your test results in hand, and then we'll consider your request for an operating permit. Okay.
And that kind of goes to what I was talking about at the beginning. When they submit that application to us, we'll let you guys know that has occurred.
And now that's happening, which may be a while down the road.
Yeah, maybe a while down the road.
Is that testing conducted by you guys or by a third party? Or
Independent third party.
Okay.
There are stack testing companies out there.
And we'll, occasionally we observe them. We don't have the resources to always do that, but we definitely look at the reports that are submitted. And if there's any data additional data that we need, or we're questioning, or we look at the report and
they have to follow US EPA protocols for testing.
Yeah, and they do submit that before they test. They submit a protocol to us for us to consider. Like they say, this is how we're going to do it. If there's anything that we think is amiss, we'll tell them, okay, no, you need to do it a different way. Usually, that's not an issue because everybody knows what. Everybody, meaning the companies that conduct stack testing, they know what the requirements are, and they submit that and say, we'll follow the requirements. And
so what do you actually do to decommission a rotary furnace? So when three comes online and receives its operating permit, two then is, it's the way it says here is permanently cease operation. What do you actually have to do in order to achieve that?
Well, that probably terminology would get it right in a legal permitting effect that it's been permanently ceased operation. But you're asking, of course, what's that practically mean? And typically when you're dealing with furnaces, incinerators that are fired with natural gas, you're talking about cutting off the gas supply to it. And like I said, in this instance, they're moving the ductwork from it. So now whether they're going to physically haul that thing out to the scrapyard and recycle it, I don't know about that. If it's physically coming out of the building, or if it's just, hey, here's a relic that's going to sit there in the corner of the shop floor and lined with refractory brick once they, you know, it's those practical implications of when they get cold, it cracks, but that's not really what you're asking.
So will you guys go physically inspect to make sure that the gas line has been cut?
I'm sure that's something we'll take a look at. Yeah, yes. I mean, I don't know that we'll, yes. I mean, yes.
All right.
Generally, when we conduct our inspections, yeah, we'll go out there and, yeah.
Because the removal of the ductwork doesn't help, because that would just mean that if the gas line was intact, they could still use it, and it just would pollute throughout, right?
Yeah, I mean, that would be
that happens inside a building without the ductwork. But
that would be a huge deal.
I guess another consideration for a source in a non-attainment area is that on our inspection work plan, they're inspected on a higher frequency than the source of that size may otherwise be.
So will the reclassification of attainment happen before this third one comes online? Because
I don't know what this, we submit it up to US EPA and then it's kind of on their schedule. That doesn't always happen super quickly.
I
don't know what the time frame is on that. I mean, again, but this is not doing anything to the lead emissions.
Sure.
It's not changing production or, you know, the heat rate input is changing the emissions profile slightly for the natural gas combustion emissions.
Right, how much stuff they're dumping into the furnace and melting and pouring, and that's not changing.
That's not changing.
They're not.
It's just the burn.
If I correctly understand your question, you are concerned that upon redesignation to attainment status, we can relax our rules.
Yeah, my concern is your inspections will be non-existent or less frequent or less effective.
No.
There's a maintenance plan in place. Once it goes through redesignation, there's a maintenance plan in place, and I don't think the inspection schedule for it was the source that was driving the non-attainment area designation, and so our maintenance plan is actually online. You could go through it and see what that looks like if you wanted to do that.
The maintenance plan would be the inspection schedule?
It's what for the non-attainment area we are going to be still doing to make sure that it remains in attainment.
Okay.
Do you know off the top of your head how frequent these inspections will be?
I don't know what the word plan. I want to say for major sources, it's every. I had to look that up.
So, what is motivating H. Kramer to do the furnace switch out? Why do they feel that this is necessary to do?
I think the answer to that is most likely it's a business decision, and probably similar to having an old car that at some point you're sick of dumping additional money into it and you'd rather buy a new car with less maintenance costs. I think that's what it comes down to. That it's just becoming, it's an older furnace and it just becomes, at some point there's a tipping point where why don't we stop dumping more and more money to keep this thing running efficiently.
And is that possible? I don't recall seeing anywhere the age of the furnaces.
Do you know?
I have indirect evidence that they were built before 1973.
Before 1973?
Yeah, because the our regulation is our performance standards which are applicable to this type of furnaces, which were built after June 11, 1973. And as far as I could see in old files, they always were addressed as a non-subject. Mm. New furnace became subject because it built out days, but it looks like number one and number two were built before these rules were promulgated.
My goodness. And so is number one then also at a point where they would need to consider a replacement furnace?
We can.
Was it the community's input about the decommissioning of Furnace 2 that prompted you to take that step? Or because the original application did not talk about decommissioning 2, it talked about using it as a backup unit? And this sounds very different now.
They submitted addendum to the application informing us that they decided do not keep furnace number two.
Right, but I think what Keith's getting, like the sequence of events,
yeah,
permit application, inquiry, clarification.
I mean, I don't think that we are able to speculate on that. I mean, they submitted it to us. You can see the dates, you know, on when the submittals were.
I have an impression
right.
that
I mean,
they
do you,
just
I don't know. Do you wanna
estimated cost of building additional duct work with low probability of using actually furnace number two. It was, I believe, pure business decision.
Mm-hmm. So I think that one of the differences is there was never, in the original application, there was never an intention to operate them at the same time.
Right.
But yes, it was a matter of them making a decision to come and say, okay, yeah, we're done. We're not even gonna have that as a backup. And
in light of the physical placement of three by comparison to two, you talked about the bag house and the efficiency at which it operates, along with a HEPA filter and this complex monitoring equipment that they're using for their pollution control equipment. Does the additional length of ductwork in any way affect that efficiency?
I think that's exactly what the testing is going to be for, which will look at CFMs, how much velocity you're getting, how much duct. We can't answer that as we sit here right now, but that's.
And in addition, both furnaces are located inside enclosure, building enclosure.
Sure.
And a new lead regulation requires a very strong requirements for monitoring of enclosure. So besides capturing efficient emission from the furnaces through this ductwork, plus uncaptured emission still stays inside negative
secondary
pressure
capture,
yeah.
Secondary capture.
And it's ducted to the same sack, to the same big house. Mm-hmm. So if there is some loss of capture efficiency, mm-hmm. it's still within the same enclosure. But everything will be measured and documented.
And they're at that point, they would be taking the risk that there would be additional things that they would have to do in order to ensure that there is adequate capture efficiency.
Yes, definitely there are very well-defined parameters which they should achieve for capture efficiency. Mm-hmm. And plus they need to measure exhaust concentration of lead. Mm-hmm. But previous stack tests showed very wide margin of safety. Mm-hmm. They were operating 10, 20 times below what is expected from them.
So would the Kramer facility, would you then, if US EPA accepts your attainment redesignation, and you're in a maintenance protocol then, would Kramer come out of the regulations? Would you seek to remove them from the 226 lead rules, or would they remain in them?
There are no so-called sunset provisions. So it doesn't mention attainment, non-attainment status. Just those two facilities which were described should always operate for sound of this provision.
I
So how many days do we get?
Well, we were thinking the 18th. It's 10, essentially 10 days, or, I mean, it is, you, how does that sound? If we get too much farther past that, you start getting into the holiday.
Right.
And, I mean, if you need, you know,
Okay.
If the 18 is acceptable, I think that that's what we wanted to go with.
We can aim for that. So, they've voluntarily extended the deadline, or how did that?
You got
not so voluntarily yeah. extended the deadline.
You got a permit waiver.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, they gave.
Is there anything more you guys wanted to share with us?
I think that's so. Just yeah, get you know, go through the draft permits, get us your comments, and then you know, we'll review them.
And will your written response incorporate the comments that we've already made, or the questions we've already made,
Do you want a written response to those, I wasn't sure with this meeting whether that satisfied your answers for those.
Okay, we can always resubmit if we think.
Okay, yeah, resubmit if there's some you don't think were fully addressed or you want us to address in writing, resubmit.
Okay.
I believe you don't need to include questions about furnace number 2.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
Anyone else? I appreciate you guys coming out tonight.